thank you for joining this week at Prophecy in the News. What a pleasure to share this time with you every week, and I always look forward to it. I'm your host, Kevin Clarkson, joined by Dan Goodwin today. Dan is a good friend of our ministry. He is from Kentucky. He's an evangelist and prophecy teacher. Got quite a message, I think, from the Lord and insights the Lord's given him. Known to a lot of us as God's final jubilee and the teaching on that, but Dan has many other things to share, and we're excited about his newest product available called Prophecy Unsealed. It's volume 2, and we're actually going to be offering that to you today, but we're going to talk about some of the topics covered in there. Let's just turn right into it. Hello.
Hi, Brother Clarkson. Good to be with you again, and these are exciting days.
Yeah. I live
in. Every day on the news, there's something new that just fits right into this. My goodness, Russia and Syria, Iran. I mean, Ezekiel 38 is getting ready to happen.
It's the footprints in place.
Yeah.
In fact, I had a little section in our last magazine called Footprints in the Moonlight. And yeah. What I meant there was, you know, when the last blood moon cycle came and went and everybody
right.
thought, well, nothing happened. I observed that week, and I haven't heard anyone else say that. But I was kind of extra with my antennas up. What is this about? Those blood moons, and I don't make too much of them, but they relate to Israel.
They do.
The week of the fourth blood moon of that tetrad, okay, 2015,
right.
September, the very week that happened on a Sunday night, that very week Obama pulled the U.S. back from Syria, and instantly Russia stepped into the vacuum. That happened the week after the blood moon.
And I think I've got a picture of a Russian ship going up the channel,
mm-hmm.
and a reporter happened to snap a picture. I think it was that same event
yeah.
that you're talking about, which
yeah.
was very unusual.
We came out, they came in.
Right.
I call it footprints in the moonlight.
Wow, that's good.
So anyway, there you are. It
yeah.
is exciting times. And really, one of the big keys of the end is going to be the destruction of Mystery Babylon. So we want to talk about that. And
yep.
This product that we're going to be offering to people in a moment, these are presentations on DVD. It's as if you're at a prophecy conference and you're presenting and speaking with PowerPoint
screen
all
right
kinds
beside
of
me.
Information. So Mystery Babylon, my goodness, from Genesis to Revelation, Babylon is a presence.
Right. It is, all the way back to Nimrod
yes.
in Genesis 10.
Right. What are some of the things that you cover in this particular
Okay, it's about 45
session.
Minutes long. It's one of my favorite topics. I love to talk about Babylon. In the session, there's five things, basically, that I hit that I think will help folks.
Okay.
Number one, I tell them there's more than one Babylon. So that throws people off. There's more than one Babylon to understand. Number two, I give prophetic truths about Babylon, what it means to prophecy people. In the session, we talk about Satan's false trinity. Because, see, God has a trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Satan also, the great counterfeiter, he has a trinity. Satan would represent God the Father. The Antichrist would represent Jesus. You hate to say that, but he does. The man comes on the white horse in mm-hmm. Revelation 6, is an imitator. He's a false Christ, and he
right.
shows up on the white horse just like Jesus did. In fact, I believe he'll fulfill the seven feasts. I believe he may have already fulfilled some of them, but that's for another lecture.
All right.
And so Satan's false trinity, of course, and then the third part of the trinity would be the false prophet representing the Holy Spirit. By the way, the Holy Spirit's job is what? Point you to Jesus. What's the false prophet do? He points people to the Antichrist.
Right.
And that's the one world religious leader. We believe it's the Roman Church. We talk about religious and political Babylon. Very important that your viewers understand that. Religious Babylon, political Babylon. And then lastly, and in great controversy, who is Babylon in the Bible? And I give my take on that.
That's good. These are some really good areas that you're wading into here. Now, you just said, you know, the word Babylon itself can mean confusion. You said there's a lot of confusion about confusion. About
there is
Babylon.
A lot of confusion about confusion.
So there's
a lot of
confusion about Babylon. What do you?
In other words,
why is that?
There's different views today, and I don't think we had these different views 20 years ago, 30 years ago. They've come in recent years, and by the way, good men. Some of these men I preach with.
Some of them are friends of mine.
Right.
Different opinions.
Good brothers. Yeah, we all disagree on certain mm-hmm. things. And there's much confusion on who Babylon is, who mystery Babylon is, who the Babylon of the end times is, who's going to be the one world political theater in the end times.
Right.
Some people think it's the literal, actual place called Babylon in the Bible. Some people believe it's Turkey. Some people believe it's America. But here's the statement that I make. Much of the confusion...
Is
about,
that a confession there?
That's a confession. Much of the confusion about the mystery of Babylon exists because there's not one Babylon to contend with, but three. And that's what my video will bring out, and I hope people understand there's not one Babylon. And that's why we're confused when we read our Bible. You got to understand what it's talking about. Mm-hmm. There's not one Babylon, there's three Babylons.
I may just cite a scripture for us as we're going to continue on these lines, but Revelation 17 identifies mystery Babylon, the harlot, which is the false religion. But chapter 18 moves into the realm of economic, commercial
right.
Babylon. It says in verse 1, after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great authority or power, and the earth was lightened with his glory, and he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird.
Pretty bad. I don't want to be here for that.
And the nations of the earth are drunk with that spirit.
Dr. Clarkson, that place exists right now.
Yeah.
It's here. It's not maybe not what exactly to the degree of that, but it's here, and it's in place. And people need to realize, when you read Revelation 17, which is what I thought you were going to read, the bold print there in your
right.
Bible,
Mystery Babylon
the great, mother of harlots. That's talking about the religious Babylon,
right.
The false prophet's kingdom, the one, all the religions coming together under the headship of the Antichrist, with the false prophet being the religious man. You turn the page, you go to Revelation 18, and it's talking about Babylon falling again, and you get confused. And now you folks, I know on your website you have my Revelation study guide that folks can get as well. I deal in great detail with Revelation 17 and 18, but Revelation 17 is political Babylon. Revelation 18 is, Revelation 17 is religious Babylon.
And 18.
And the fall of it. And 18 changes to the political system, economic and financial and political, and that's the fall of him and his kingdom. And very interesting stuff. Very scary if you think you're gonna imagine being here for that and not being saved and being left behind and living through what you just read there.
So the question maybe that we all wonder is, who is religious Babylon?
I believe religious Babylon is the Roman Church, and I've met Roman Church people. I've met Catholics who've told me the same thing. It's
yeah.
almost, oh yeah, we're in the future we're gonna be that one world church. It's gonna go bad, and isn't that awful, huh?
Tell us some reasons you land there.
Well, there's a lot of reasons. The colors, the scarlet, the talks about the chalices and things in Revelation mm-hmm. 17. There's a lot of description there. Also, when you look at the traditions, and of course I grew up Roman Catholic. I used to be an altar boy. I used to ring the bells and pass the wine and all that stuff, wear that robe and march around the aisle there. And there's good Catholic people. I've got good friends that are Catholic. I'm not down in Catholics. I'm just saying the Roman Catholic Church meets the description
yes.
of this Babylonian institute that's going to be in existence during the tribulation. Because a lot of their traditions go all the way back to Nimrod in Genesis 10. Purgatory and a lot of the symbols and the idols and the statues and all the things, the mother of God and all that, that goes right back to Nimrod and his mother, some of the terrible things that happened back then. So these are all figurative things. Of course, that brings us back to this thing about the mystery of Babylon and the fact that there's three Babylons. See, Babylon, you got to look at it this way. There's literal Babylon, where's that? That's mm-hmm. that. In fact, on the PowerPoint, I show a map. I show a picture of some rubble and some debris and whatnot that's actually in Babylon right now in Iraq. By the way, if that's the Babylon of Revelation 18, We can unpack our suitcases. We're not going home for a long time because that's just rubble over there. If that's got to be the commercial center of the world, the financial center of the world, I mean, Revelation 18 talks about the shipmen, the merchants weeping when they see the smoke rising mm-hmm. from the destruction of Babylon, which happens at the end of the tribulation, and they're weeping because it's gone and they made their living from it. If that's got to be Babylon in Iraq, we've got decades before the rapture happens because it's rubble. There's nobody would cry if Babylon, nobody would even know. It's already rubble. So I got a couple pictures in the DVD that show what Babylon, literal Babylon, looks like. So we got literal Babylon. That's Iraq. That's over in Iraq. It's a place you could get on a plane, go visit if you dare. But then there's figurative Babylon. Sometimes the Bible's talking about Babylon in a figurative sense. That would mean it would have attributes and characteristics of Nimrod's Babylon. Mm-hmm. Or you could fast forward to Nebuchadnezzar's day in the book of Daniel. That's also Babylon.
True.
And, you know, idolatry, statues, I mean, all that. So Babylon, it has a figurative thought to it. And then thirdly, which is most applicable to what we're discussing here, is there's prophetic Babylon. Prophetic Babylon is not necessarily just a physical place. It would have figurative characteristics as well. And so it's very important that we understand that.
Who do you see then as political Babylon?
Political,
you've already answered.
You had to ask.
You raised your hand.
Political Babylon. And anyone that knows me, follows my YouTube channel, or reads my books, you folks already know. I believe that America fits the description of mm-hmm. mystery Babylon. Not the religious one, but the political Babylon. Revelation 18.
Right.
When you read that, and you read about the smoke and the shipmen and the merchants, and in fact, I have a picture that I found on the internet that I used in the DVD. The producers maybe will put that up for you, but it has a picture of a great big ship. Remember them, the old container ships that pulls up to the dock. Outside is semi-trucks getting ready to get the containers, and there's a man with an iPhone, and he's putting in an order or whatever. To me, that's Babylon. That's Babylon. It's not just a place. It's a commerce center. It's a philosophy. I believe America is the center of the world, I believe, financially and politically. I'll ask people, I say, where's the United Nations at? Is that in Great Britain? No, it's right here in America. It's in Manhattan. Mm-hmm. We run the whole world, politically, financially. I realize there's still borders. There's still, you got presidents and of other countries. They have their own laws. But basically, we run the world right here for America. We saw that in 2008.
Right.
Some of you remember 2008. I remember watching the news, and politicians would come up. They were literally shaking. They were talking about the stock market crash and the financial system. They were begging for something to be done. And, of course, Congress did something. But what was happening was America was falling financially.
Foretaste of chapter 18.
Yeah. And it was falling. But what was happening at the same time, the rest of the world was crumbling. The stock mm-hmm, markets mm-hmm. worldwide began to crumble.
Right. Meltdown.
And people in other countries were shaking. Why? Because America was falling. We are the center of the world right here.
Well, let me just ask you, you end this section with a quote about Babylon. What is that quote?
That quote is this: Babylon, and this is very important, people need to think of Babylon in a certain way. Babylon, it's literal, it's religious, it's political, it's figurative, but look at Babylon this way. And when you read your Bible, think of Babylon like this. Babylon is a philosophy, a system, more so than a physical location. When you read Revelation 17, Revelation 18, and you look at Babylon in this light, I think it'll help your mm-hmm. your viewers to try to understand that. Don't try to make Babylon a place over there in Iraq, and don't even try to make it to be a place here in America. It's a system. It's a philosophy. It's a way of doing things. And it's centered, I believe, right here, New York City. By the way, people tell me, well, the Antichrist, he can't come from America. America can't be. It's got to be out of the revived Roman Empire. I agree with that. And I'll ask people, I say, where did America come from? We're the lion's cub. Mm-hmm. We came from Europe. We are Europe. Our whole judicial system, Black's law books, they came from England.
Right.
The whole financial system we have has its roots in Great right. Britain. And our morality, I mean, everything about us, it came from England, from Europe. We are Europe. And I often, people ask me who I think the Antichrist is. I still have the same opinion. I happen to think President Obama meets the description in my mind of the Antichrist. People argue with me about it, but they say, "Oh no, he's got to come out of Europe." Well, where did he come from? He's a mystery man. Mm-hmm. He has no beginning and no end. Nobody's ever seen his birth certificate. I don't think anybody ever will. Nobody. They say he's got a Connecticut Social Security number. That can't be his. I don't know. I don't know if he's the Antichrist or not. He's my first guess, but I don't know. He's not going to be revealed till we're gone, but. There's a lot of things about him. You know, Melchizedek's the type of Christ. Mm-hmm. He had no mother, no father, no beginning, no end. Does that sound like somebody we know? So anyway, I just throw that out there. I don't know who the Antichrist is, but he's my first guess, and he still is. By the way, he's wanting to get to become the president of the United Nations.
Sure, sure.
That's his goal.
He's aspired to that.
That will be interesting. Keep an eye on that.
Well, our guest is Dan Goodwin, if you've joined us. And we are offering what we're speaking of comes from Volume 2 of a series called Prophecy Unsealed. And this is four presentations. They deal with the final generation, the unknown day, what we just spoke of, Mystery Babylon, and what we're going to speak of in the next part of this program, the seven-seal book of Revelation. These four presentations are each about 45 minutes or more on this DVD. They're Dan speaking, but they're also with PowerPoint and a lot of information presented visually for you. And this is available for $24.95. We're also reaching back into the archive and pulling up Volume 1 of Prophecy Unsealed. And you had four sessions as well on the Seven Feasts of Israel and the prophetic significance they hold, God's Jubilee, the barley harvest and what that means, and then the idea of when time shall be no more. This also is available for $24.95 plus shipping and handling. Or we're putting them together for combination. You can have both of these for $44.95 shipping and handling. Now, how would you acquire those? Well, as always, you go to a bookstore online at our website, prophecyinthenews.com, or call the 800 number on your screen, and an operator will be there to assist you placing your order. We would love to hear from you. This material will not only bless you, I think it will inform you and equip you, give you what you need, not only to be better living in these days, but really to be able to present the material to others to help them be ready, because the Lord's return is at hand. I really believe it is.
And Dr. Clarkson, those sessions are it's a prophecy conference coming right to your living room.
Yeah.
It's exactly what I would do at a prophecy conference. The same slideshow that I use, some of the same jokes. I mean, it's a prophecy conference right in your living room if you can't afford to get out or can't go.
Yeah.
Just good stuff, down to earth, on the bottom shelf, understandable.
Amen. Well, we have in the time that remains to speak about the Seven Seal book, which really is the whole key to unlock the book of Revelation, I think. And you do bring a good understanding of this. Tell us a little bit about what is in this session.
All right, in the seventh, this is the fourth session on the DVD set, and it's called the Seven Seal Book. In this session, we talk about what is this Seven Seal Book. We talk about dominion of planet Earth and what that means. Of course, dominion is ownership, authority. Mm-hmm. And Adam was given that. We'll talk about that. And give a great detail to that in the DVD, and the fact that Satan got dominion of the world when Adam sinned, and still has it, by the way. But his days are numbered.
Indeed.
And one of these days, pretty soon, he's going to lose that dominion, and somebody else is going to claim it. What is a title deed? We talk about that. Now, we have those of you that own a house, you've got a deed. Now, on the back of your deed, it might have some other writing from First National Bank or Chase Bank, mm-hmm. because they actually own it and you're making payments, but you have a mortgage on it. And see, that's what the Seven Seal Book is. It's been mortgaged because of sin, and somebody's got to pay that mortgage. That somebody is Jesus Christ, And that time it's going to happen is, according to Daniel 9, the 70th week is when it's going to be that debt, that mortgage will be paid, and Christ will come back with the ownership of the earth. And he is our kinsman redeemer. We talk about the kinsman redeemer right out of the book of Ruth. Beautiful, beautiful four chapters of a love story in the book of Ruth. But we also learn the law of the kinsman redeemer and what that means. And, of course, Jesus is our kinsman redeemer. So that's what's in that session. I love the seven seal book. Mm-hmm. I love to talk about it. I love to, because like you said a moment ago, you'll never understand Revelation chapter 6 through chapter 19, which is, by the way, the entire tribulation takes place from chapter 6 to 19. Mm-hmm. Revelation 1 is kind of an introduction, shows Christ's relationship to his church. Chapter 2 and 3 is the seven churches, very prophetic about the whole entire church age. You turn the page, Revelation 4, John is caught up, there's the rapture. And then chapter 5 shows us this seven seal book and somebody crying out, who's worthy to open that book? And then, of course, chapter 6 through chapter 19 is the entire tribulation. If you don't understand chapter 5, you'll miss what's going on.
Right.
Very important.
Well, let's dive into chapter 5. I might want to just perhaps turn to it in our Bibles in Revelation 5 and maybe just kind of start it off here. John has been caught up to heaven, and he turns and sees the throne. And
yeah.
Then a scene unfolds after he describes what he sees, the worship there. That he sees in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. And a strong angel I saw proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof.
And at your church the other night we did this, and I like to act it out.
Yeah.
And I can see this strong angel standing up, pumping his chest out. And cupping his hand, who's worthy to open the book and to loose the seven seals? I can hear that ringing mm-hmm. throughout heaven. And, of course, no man was found. The next verse says, no man in heaven or in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book. Now, that under the earth, I take that to mean under the earth, hell. But mm-hmm. no man in heaven, no man in earth, no man anywhere was found worthy to open the book and to look thereon. And John wept much in verse 4. Didn't say he wept. It says he wept much. John is in heaven. He's just been raptured. And he's crying. And that messes up our doctrine a little bit. Don't mm-hmm. we always mm-hmm. preach at funerals and in sermons we
no
preach about
tears.
Heaven. There'll be no more tears. Well, I guess we got a problem here. John's weeping. He's not just weeping. He's uncontrollably weeping.
Mm-hmm.
Why is he weeping? Because no man was found worthy to open the book, and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And then, of course, one of the elders said unto me, weep not, John. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, that prevailed to open the book. And we won't read the rest of it here, but Jesus Christ comes up to the throne, takes the book out of the right hand of him that sitteth on the throne, who we understand is the Father, takes the book out of his hand. By the way, there's the Trinity. God the Father on the throne, mm-hmm. the Son takes the book out of his hand. The Holy Ghost is there too. And takes the book out of his hand. You turn the page to Revelation 6. He opens the first seal. Jesus Christ himself orchestrates the tribulation period, that suffering and death that's going to happen. The Lamb, that mild and meek Jesus, is going to orchestrate all the death and all the destruction and judgment upon the earth. He begins to open those seals. So what a passage, what a story. And here's John weeping. And of course, well, you know, one of the questions people ask is, what's he crying for? Well, mm-hmm. he's got good reason to be crying, because if that book doesn't get opened, Dr. Clarkson, then the earth doesn't get redeemed.
Right.
The mortgage doesn't get paid off. Satan maintains ownership and the title deed of the earth. He wins. I don't like that, because we know that God wins in the end. In fact, God has already won when he paid the sin debt on the cross. It's already finished. Jesus said so. But if that means Jesus and the saints can't come back to the earth, the kingdom can't be set up. In fact, Daniel 9:27, the last thing in that list of what happens during the tribulation, the purpose of the tribulation, you know, put an end to sin, a whole list of things there. The last thing mentioned is, and to anoint the most holy. That's Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
The last thing that happens at the end of the tribulation, as Christ comes on the white horse, in his hand will be this seven sealed scroll. He'll end the battle of Armageddon. It takes that long, and just goes on, keeps on going. Goes to the Mountain of Olives, comes down the Kidron Valley into the Eastern Gate, and he's going to set up the kingdom.
Amen.
And he's going to be anointed King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He'll have the title deed to the planet in his hand. That's reason to cry. If that doesn't happen, then God, the scriptures are not fulfilled. Prophecy will not be fulfilled, and God will be a liar. Now do you understand why John is weeping uncontrollably? That's pretty serious stuff, and he understood that.
As some of our contemporaries say, it's a big deal.
It's a big deal.
It's huge.
And ain't it great? It's all under control. It's all going to happen according to God's plan.
A lot of us think too small. I mean, we don't mean to, but it's the way we are. We think about ourselves, and we think salvation means, oh boy, I got saved, my sins got forgiven. Well, that's part of it, but it happened to you because of this big deal.
That's right.
He reclaims what was lost, what right. Adam fumbled away and the snake took.
Yep.
He comes and crushes and the serpent's head.
And there's a lesson there. I know we don't have time to dwell on it, but somebody asked me in question and answer the other night, why did Satan get possessed? Because Satan's the one that threw the hook out there. He got it by default.
Right.
Amazing.
Well, it really is. And, we don't have time to really go into all the kinsman redeemer aspect. No. But that's why, in fact, Jesus became a man, became as we are, partook of flesh and blood, participated in humanity, that he might redeem us back to himself. And not only us and our soul, but the land. The property.
And you tie the Jubilee. My ministry revolves around the Jubilee. The Jubilee's right at the center of this.
It is. It is.
He's coming back on a Jubilee to reclaim, take back possession of the planet.
Yeah. That's an exciting thing.
He's coming soon.
It just gives me chills to think about. Yeah. We're so near the edge. Jesus will come back. I wonder if you're ready. I wonder if he's got the title deed to your life, I have seen people go off the deep end in their rebellion and running from God, and sometimes they almost throw back over their shoulder, it's my life, I can do what I want with it. But you know what the Lord says? All souls are mine.
Yeah.
You belong to God, whether you give it to him or not. You belong to him, he made you, and he has every right to send you to hell forever. And he's not cruel and he's not wicked, but don't get high and mighty. He's the Almighty, and he owns title to everything. It's all his. And one day we will all stand before him and give an account of our lives. And the only way to be redeemed and have your life bought back is by surrendering to Jesus Christ. And we urge you to call on him today and be saved. He is coming back, so let's keep looking up. Amen.